Hello, dear friends. Turn with me, please, to the 11th chapter of the Epistle to the Hebrews. The 11th chapter to the Epistle to the Hebrews. Hebrews 11 is generally known as the faith chapter, and so it is. It's rightly called the faith chapter. But upon reading it carefully, we see that it could co-equally be called the hope chapter. The hope chapter. Biblically, faith and hope are inextricably interlinked. In fact, the definitions of faith and hope, in the sense that the New Testament uses them, are mutually dependent, in a sense, as we read it in Hebrews chapter 11. Now, faith is the assurance, or the substance, of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. Faith is the assurance, or the substance, of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. There are three key Greek words in this text. The first is pistes. Pistes and its variant piston are the Greek word for faith, or the Greek words for faith from the Hebrew emunah. They're the equivalent of the Hebrew emunah. In Hebrew, we get the word amen from emunah. It is faithful, so be it. Now, we have to point out the underlying Hebrew background, because the Epistle to the Hebrews is, of course, written to Messianic Jews, to Jewish Christians during the first century. More of that in a moment. The second word is hypostasis, or hypostasis. Hypostasis, translated usually as assurance, means substance, substance. The underlying Hebrew thought would likely be the word homer, homer. And finally, we have the word elexos, elexos, what is being hoped for, what is being hoped for. Pistes, hypostasis, and elexos, faith, substance, and what is being hoped for. In other words, we can have faith in what we're hoping for because it has substance. The way we understand this is to look at the epistle itself. The book of Hebrews is a book written to Jewish Christians, Messianic Jews, probably around 62 AD. The Emperor Nero is ascending to power in Rome. Until now, the church has faced persecution in Israel and in Jerusalem by the Sanhedrin and the rabbinic establishment. But now, for the first time, there's another daunting prospect. The church is about to face persecution, not only from their fellow Jews who don't believe, but from Imperial Rome. As we know from Eusebius and the historical record, the Emperor Nero would go on to martyr the apostles Peter and Paul. So the Jewish believers in and around Jerusalem at this time are caught in a situation where they're facing rejection and persecution from the rabbinic establishment. At the same time, now they're facing the specter of persecution by Imperial Rome. Persecution, as it were, from within their community, but also by the foreign occupying power. And such it is. We don't know who wrote Hebrews, but it was obviously someone associated with the Apostle Paul and knew his theology well. One educated guess might be Apollos. Luther, among others, thought Apollos wrote Hebrews. The situation these believers were facing is this. Some were being tempted to go back under the law and trust in the Mosaic covenant for salvation, as it were, renouncing faith in Jesus in order to gain religious license from the Roman authorities. Under pagan Rome, there were two kinds of religions, religio licita and religio illicita, a legal and an illegal, or more specifically, a licensed and an unlicensed religion. Rome didn't care what religion you had as long as you bowed the knee to the pontiff, the Pontificus Maximus, who was the emperor, the head of the pagan pantheon, a title later bequeathed to the popes. As long as you acknowledge the emperor as pontiff, you'd have no problem. Now the Jews made a deal. Instead of sacrificing to the emperor as a god, they would sacrifice for him, and they were given a license. As long as the gospel, as long as Christianity was seen as messianic Judaism, as long as it remained a sect within the synagogue, it was protected by imperial law. However, something would happen eventually that was a done deal by roughly 90 AD that was a curse incorporated into the synagogue ritual and liturgy eventually on Jewish believers or on Messianic Jews called Habirkat Haminim. Habirkat Haminim. And it was eventually incorporated into the synagogue liturgy, or the siddur for the synagogue, into the Shmona Esrei, into the synagogue list of 18 blessings. But it was a curse on Jews who believed. The rudiments of this, however, were much, much earlier, going back at least to the time of Nero's reign. So some Jews who believed were being tempted to go back under the law. Now remember, the secular Jewish historian Max Demont, in his popular Jewish history, God, the Jews in History, records how perhaps 25% of the Jewish population of Jerusalem in the first century and into the second century believed that Jesus was the Messiah. Very high percentage. By the time of Bar Kokhba's rebellion in the second century, the early second century, about a quarter of the Jews in and around Jerusalem believed that Jesus was the promised Messiah. So they're being tempted to go back and trust in the Torah, the law, for their salvation, putting faith in Jesus aside to avoid persecution. The writer of Hebrews is keen to remind them that there is no salvation outside of the Messiah who has fulfilled the Torah. The book of Hebrews, in this sense, is an inspired commentary on the book of Leviticus, explaining and detailing through typology and shadows how the book of Leviticus is a book of types, shadows of the Messiah and what he would do. Now this is important in understanding what's being said in chapter 11, verse 1. Faith is the substance, the assurance. It is like holding up your hand and seeing a shadow. You can't see the hand on the wall or on the surface, but you can see the shadow. Yet you can have absolute assurance that there is a hand, even though you're only looking at the shadow, because you know what is causing the shadow has substance to it. Well, that's the way the law was. The law was a shadow of what the Messiah would be and do. The high priest, Melchizedek, the temple worship, these things were shadows, types of the Messiah, as explained in Hebrews. You couldn't see the Messiah, but you knew there was one. You could see the shadow. You knew that the promise had substance. Hence, the Jews could hope in and trust in the coming of the Messiah because they knew the promise had substance. This same idea is now transported into chapter 11. The same as Old Testament Israel could have faith that the Messiah was coming, we can have faith on the same basis. Even though we may only see a shadow, we know that what's causing the shadow indeed has substance. Faith is the assurance, the substance, hypostasis, again, the hand causing the shadow of what is hoped for. Simply stated then, by biblical definition, as the New Testament uses these terms, hope is a future fact. You can have faith in a fact, but hope is a future fact. You can have faith in what you hope in because it has substance to it. Now the writer of Hebrews is aware of the warnings of Jesus and the prophecies of the prophet Daniel in chapter 9. that the Messiah would come and die before the second temple would be destroyed. A 40-year grace period from the time of Jesus to 70 AD is in effect, giving Israel and the Jews a chance to accept Jesus as the Messiah. By the time we reach 70 AD and the temple is destroyed, all Jews had one of two choices. Either they realize the Messiah has come and fulfilled the Torah, or they invent a form of Judaism that is not biblical. And that is what happened. We call this the Tale of Two Rabbis, and we have tapes explaining this. St. Paul was a disciple of Rabbi Gamaliel, who was the grandson of Rabbi Hillel, the founder of the Pharisaic school of Hillel. There were two types of Pharisees, the school of Shammai and the school of Hillel. St. Paul was from the school of Hillel, and he was a student of Rabbi Gamaliel, the grandson of the founder. Now, the rabbinic writings in the Mishnah tell us that when Rabbi Gamaliel died, he was such a righteous man, what Jews would call a tzaddik, that righteousness perished from the earth with his death. He was a heralded rabbi. The New Testament in the book of Acts, however, tells us something else about Rabbi Gamaliel, St. Paul's tutor. That, according to Rabbi Gamaliel, if Jesus is not the Messiah, Christianity would disappear. Well, Christianity did not disappear, it grew. Hence, based on the standard set by this great rabbi, with whose death other rabbis said righteousness perished from the earth, Jesus, therefore, must be the Messiah, because Christianity did not disappear. All the other false messiahs came and went, including the false messiahs heralded by the rabbis through the centuries. Jacob Frank, Shabbatai Svi, Simon Bar Kokhba, none of these fulfilled the messianic prophecies Yeshua, Jesus, did. However, let's go back to the tale of two rabbis. St. Paul's classmates, as it were famous in number. One was Rabbi Anklios, who translated a famous translation of the Hebrew canon into Aramaic called the Targum Anklios. It is one of the two main Targums, or Targumim, translations into Aramaic. One is the Targum Yonatan, and the other is the Targum Anklios. Anklios, in fact, was a Jew whose parents were Garim, Gentiles who converted to Judaism, as later would be Rabbi Akiva, the son of converts to Judaism, Garim. But another classmate of St. Paul's would have been Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, known in Judaism as the Mighty Hammer. Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, when the Romans surrounded Jerusalem in 70 AD, was snuck out of the city in a casket, as it were. And once the temple was destroyed, Israel faced this dilemma. Daniel prophesied that the Messiah would come and die before the second temple would be destroyed. The second temple was now destroyed, the Messiah had to come. And we have references to this in Sanhedrin, in the rabbinic tractates. Oy vavoy lanu, woe to us, for the temple's destroyed. Where's the Messiah? Would be the natural question. Biblical Judaism, the Judaism of Moses and the Torah, could no longer be practiced. No more Levitical priesthood as such, no more high priest, no more temple sacrifice. So Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai convened a conference at a place called Yavne, not far from the modern city of Tel Aviv. And at Yavne, various things happened. A formalization of the Hebrew canon was agreed upon, but also a decision was made to begin what we would call Talmudic Judaism, which began as Rabbinic Judaism, but evolved into the Talmudic Judaism you see today, where instead of the Levite and the high priest, you would have the rabbi, where instead of the synagogue, you would have the temple as the focus of Jewish worship, where instead of the sacrificial system, you'd have the mitzvot, good works, and a system of halakha, Jewish rabbinic law, to perpetuate these things. Instead of the Sanhedrin, you'd have the Bet Din with a Dayan, a Jewish religious judge. another Judaism is invented, fulfilling the prophecies of Jeremiah chapter 2. My people have committed two evils against me. They've forsaken me, the fountain of living water. That's the Messiah who'd give the living water, as in Isaiah 44:3, John chapter 7, verse 39, and John chapter 4. They'd reject the Messiah who'd give the Holy Spirit, the living water, Maim Hayim, to who for themselves cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. They'd invent another religion that would be, as it were, spiritually bankrupt. Now, upon his deathbed, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai was terrified. And it's recorded in the Mishnaic writings that he was weeping. And his Talmidav, his students, came to him and said to him, "O mighty hammer, why do you weep?" And he said, "I'm about to meet Hashem, God, blessed be his name. Before me there are two roads, one to Gehenna, hell, and one to paradise, and I know not to which he will sentence me." Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, who began Talmudic Judaism as it became, who began Rabbinic Judaism as an alternative to the Torah, died a terrified man with no assurance of salvation, not knowing if he was going to heaven or hell, not knowing if he even did the right thing. He had a classmate, however, in addition to Anklios, who was of some renown. His classmate was Rabbi Shaul of Tarsus, better known as Paul the Apostle, who began by persecuting Jewish Christians, Messianic Jews. Upon his deathbed, however, his classmate, Shaul of Tarsus, said, "I have run the good race, I fought the good fight. Hence I know there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness." He had the assurance of salvation, knowing that Yeshua fulfilled the Torah, that Jesus was his blood atonement, who paid the price for his sin, and the law was now fulfilled through faith in the Messiah, who kept it perfectly. Even though the temple was destroyed, as Daniel prophesied, the Messiah had come. That was the background. Every Jew would, from that point on, in 70 AD, follow one of these two rabbis. They would either follow Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai or his classmate, Rabbi Shaul of Tarsus. One who died terrified of meeting his maker, and the other who boldly approached the eternal throne. And so it is to this day. Every Jew will follow the sure way of salvation, or a way that its own founder admitted was not secure. But let's continue. The temple was going to be destroyed, and the writer of Hebrews was, among other things, trying to tell these Jewish believers who were being tempted to go back under the law and trust in the law for salvation, not to do that. The temple was still standing at this point, but they knew from what Daniel prophesied and from what Jesus warned of in the Olivet Discourse and Matthew 24 and Luke 21 that the temple was going to be destroyed. Don't trust in it, it's going to be destroyed. That was the background of Hebrews. With these things in view, let's continue looking at this chapter, the faith chapter, from the aspect of hope. Let's look at it today as the hope chapter. We have other tapes looking at it as the faith chapter. The Emunah tape looks at it from the point of view of faith. Now we're looking at it from the point of view of hope. Tikva. Tikva in Hebrew is hope. Faith is the assurance, the hypostasis, of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. For by it, men of old gained approval. Now that word for conviction in Greek, that word for conviction in Greek actually means evidence, prima facie evidence, hard proof evidence. For by it, men of old gained approval. By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. By faith Abel offered to God a better sacrifice than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous, God testifying about his gifts. And through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. The men of old gained approval by their faith, by having a trust in what they hoped in. And it goes through a list of figures associated with the major phases of Israel's history. Salvation history is called by theologians by the German term Heilsgeschichte, Heilsgeschichte, salvation history. And it lists the major phases of salvation history, or of Heilsgeschichte, from the creation all the way to the time of the Babylonian captivity, essentially from the time of the creation to the time of the kings and prophets, which ended with the Babylonian captivity. The Jews were waiting for a Messiah to come and restore the Davidic kingdom. Hence, the list of role models ends with King David. They wanted somebody to restore the Davidic monarchy and kingdom that was lost with the captivity. Now, we understand by faith that the worlds were prepared by the word of God. This is what we call a Christological statement. It's a statement about the Messiah as creator. When we read the Jewish scholar Rashi from the Middle Ages, in his commentary on Genesis, he says some very interesting things about Proverbs chapter 8 that are very much akin to what Christians believe. Proverbs chapter 8 shows the Messiah involved in the creation, God making the universe through him. And we read this in John chapter 1. En arche ton ho logos, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh. The world was made through him, through the Logos, the Logos. Logos is the Greek word for the incarnate Word. Its Hebrew equivalent is Dvar, Dvar Adonai, and its Aramaic equivalent, Mamre, Mamre. Hence, by faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the Messiah, who is the Word, the Logos, the incarnate Word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible. Only God can make something ex nihilo. Only God can create something out of nothing, and he does it by his Word. His Word, however, is not a word. It is his Word, definite possessive article, the Messiah. By faith, Abel offered to God a sacrifice better than Cain, through which he obtained the testimony that he was righteous, God testifying about his gifts. And through faith, though he is dead, he still speaks. The first phase after the creation that the writer of Hebrews deals with is the fall. And the character associated with the fall we are given is Abel. Abel's name in Hebrew is Hevel, Hevel, and it has the connotation of being, as it were, insignificant or someone less significant, Hevel or Abel. Jesus spoke of Abel as the first martyr in Matthew chapter 23. We read in the book of Genesis, Bereshit, God says to Cain, your brother's blood is crying out to me. And so we read the same language about the martyrs in the book of Revelation. The blood of the martyrs was crying out from under the altar to God. First martyr. And though he's dead, he still speaks. He still speaks though he's dead. You have the underlying current of resurrection as a theme in the text. Though he's dead, he still speaks. Isaiah is dead, but he still speaks. Jeremiah is dead, but he still speaks. Paul is dead, but he still speaks. They still speak for two reasons. One, they are alive in eternity in the Messiah. And two, because the Bible is the Word of God in the Word of man, and God's Word, His Logos, is eternal. Because the Messiah is eternal, and because the Messiah is the Logos, so the Word of God is eternal. Let's understand this. Yeshua, Jesus, is fully human and fully divine. Fully human and fully divine. 100% God and 100% man. So the Bible, the Word of God, is fully human and fully divine. It is 100% the Word of God and 100% the Word of man. It is the Word of God in the Word of man. The same as Jesus was God in man, so the Bible is the Word of God in the Word of man. The book of Isaiah is 100% the Word of God, but it's 100% the Word of Isaiah. The book of Jeremiah is 100% the Word of Jeremiah, yet it's 100% the Word of God. Jeremiah is still speaking to Israel and to the church. Isaiah is still speaking both to Israel and to the church. The apostles are still speaking. Though they're dead, they still speak because they're alive in Christ in eternity, and the Word of God is eternal because the Messiah is the Word of God, the eternal Logos. They continue to speak though they're dead. Isaiah, Paul, Jeremiah, they're still speaking today. The things in the book of Jeremiah are speaking to Israel and the Jewish people today, and much of it applies to the church. The things that Paul and the apostles wrote to the early churches apply to the modern church today, just as much as the day they were written. And in some ways, with eschatological material, they even apply more to today than they did to the day they were written. Though they are dead, still they speak. Abel had this assurance. By faith, Enoch was taken up so that he should not see death, and he was not found because God took him up. For he obtained a witness that before his being taken up, he was pleasing to God. We begin after the creation with the fall represented by Abel. Now we move to the next phase of salvation history. This is the antediluvian age, the age before the flood. And the figure given us here is Enoch, in Hebrew, Hanok. Enoch. Enoch is made reference to in the epistle to the Hebrews, in the epistle to Jude. But also, we have the apocryphal books, 1st and 2nd Enoch, which although not canon, are biblically important in history and literature. In fact, the books of Enoch are crucial in understanding the book of Revelation in terms of literary style and genre. Now, the association between Enoch of Genesis and the book of Enoch is, of course, tenuous. I simply point to it not as canon, but as history and literature. However, Enoch is the first man ever raptured. Enoch is the first man who was ever raptured. Every rapture experience in the Bible prefigures the resurrection and rapture of the church. The ascension of Jesus is a rapture. The rapture of Elijah is a rapture. In some sense, whatever happened to Paul, as he recounts it in 2 Corinthians, and what happened to John in Revelation chapter 4, verse 1, come up here or come up hither, these things are all rapture experiences that prefigure the rapture of all of us. We're going to see what John saw in Revelation 4:1. We're going to see those same things. So too, what happened to Jesus and his ascension will happen to us. But the first man ever raptured is Enoch. Why does this text begin with Abel and Enoch? It begins with the first man ever martyred and the first man ever raptured. The connotation that this would have had for the Jewish believers in the first century in and around Jerusalem is this. Persecution is coming. You may be martyred like Abel, or you may be raptured like Enoch. Now, in fact, when Jerusalem was surrounded in 70 AD, The senior pastor of the church was a cousin of Jesus called Simeon, who replaced James the apostle as pastor after James was martyred by one of the later Herods. And remembering what Jesus said in Luke 21, 24, when you see Jerusalem surrounded, flee. Under Simeon, the believers fled Jerusalem to a place called Pila in the Transjordan, not Petra, but Pila. They fled across the Transjordan and across the Jordan River into Pila. They thought this was going to be the rapture. And in some way, this flight from Jerusalem in 70 AD, as recorded by Josephus and others, prefigures the rapture of the church. While the early Christians in the first and second century thought that Jesus was likely to come in their lifetime, they allowed for the fact he might not. But they saw the escape from Jerusalem as prefiguring the rapture of the church. And they were right. In fact, their expectation was it would have been a rapture experience. You see, what happened in Jerusalem after the believers were rescued out is a microcosm of what will happen to the entire planet after the rapture. Women began eating their babies. A bad situation went from bad to worse and worse to worse still. People would fight over afterbirth to have something to eat. The starvation was so bad. And their own partisan leaders turned against the people and began to devour them, behaving more barbarian than even the Romans. What happened in 70 AD is a picture of what will happen to the entire planet after the church is removed. This parallels the book of Exodus. Those same judgments in the book of Exodus are replayed in the book of Revelation. What happened to Egypt before the Exodus is what will happen to the world with the rapture coming out of Egypt, God's people coming out. It is a picture of the coming rescue. That's why they brought Joseph's bones with them out of Egypt. The dead in Christ rise first, we come out together. Joseph representing those who died in the Lord, and Moses representing those who are alive coming out together. So, in Hebrews, we have the first martyr, and we have the first raptured person. Persecution will come, Jerusalem will be destroyed. Maybe you'll be raptured, maybe you'll be martyred. What's the difference? We have a hope in the resurrection. And the thing we hope in has substance. You can have an assurance. There's a conviction you can have. But then it continues. Without faith, it's impossible to please him, or impossible to please God, in verse 6. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who seek him. We deal with this more extensively on the Emunah tape, but without faith, it's impossible to please God. We all have a measure of faith. We're saved by grace through faith. Without faith, you can't be born again. Anything not done in faith is sin. Now, this, of course, abolishes legalistic Christianity or nomianism. The only do's and don'ts we can enforce on other people are the ones specifically found in the New Testament. The Christian life from the new birth is based on a relationship with God through a relationship with Jesus. In a relationship with someone, the do's and don'ts, the way you behave in the context of that relationship, is defined by the relationship itself. Think, for instance, of a marriage. A husband knows what pleases his wife and what doesn't. A wife knows what pleases her husband and what doesn't. The relationship itself defines what you do and what you don't. There's not a long list of rules, I will do this, you will do that, and you make a contract. Well, so it is in the faith life. There are do's and don'ts found in the Bible, but that's as far as it goes. If it's not found in the Bible, the relationship defines it. In other words, should Christians go to the movies? There's nothing in the Bible that says you can't. The question is, do you have faith to go to that movie? We're told anything not done in faith is sin. Should Christians read secular novels? Do you have faith to read it? Anything not done in faith is sin. Now, we should be more than happy to apply the do's and don'ts found in the New Testament to all of us. But be careful of those who apply do's and don'ts not found in the New Testament to others. When I see these silly denominational rule books, you shouldn't go to the circus and have a TV. The question is faith. Do you have the faith to watch television? Is what God wants you to do in that situation. The relationship defines it. Anything not done in faith is sin. If you don't have the faith to watch that thing, it's a sin if you do. Faith. Without faith, it's impossible to please God because the relationship is not alive. It's reduced to something legalistic, do's and don'ts. In a sense, it is back under the law that Jesus came to fulfill, which could only point to him, but had to be fulfilled by him, but couldn't give us him. It could only show us our need for him. The law of Moses, through the law, you could know about God. Through the old covenant, you could know about God. But through the new covenant, you can know God. Under the Torah, a Jew could know about God. But under the Brit HaHadashah, the New Testament, a Jew could know God through knowing Jesus, his son. Now, let's continue. We're told that in order to please God, you have to believe not only that God is, but that God is a rewarder of those who seek him. This connects to verse 26. Considering the reproach of the Messiah greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. That is Moses. The first reason to become a Christian, admittedly, is not to go to hell. But that's not a good enough reason. The other reason is to go to heaven. You have to believe not only that God is, but that he wants the reward. When your children or grandchildren do well in school, you want to reward them. Why do you want to reward your children for doing well academically or for behaving in a Christian way? Why do you want to reward your children? The reason we want to reward our children and our grandchildren is because we are made in the image and likeness of our Maker. And that thing that's in us as parents that makes us want to reward our children is something that God put there to teach us about himself, how he wants to reward us as his children. And sometimes you even reward your children when they haven't done so well. Why are you nice to your children sometimes when they haven't been what they should? What is it in you that makes you do that? It's to do with emotion. Well, it's something God put in us to teach about himself. How often does God bless us when we don't deserve any blessing? It's something he puts in us to teach about himself. Now, the book of Hebrews speaks of hell before it does heaven. In chapter 6 and in chapter 10, in no uncertain terms, it warns about the reality of eternal hell. Today, we have people in the church propagating a doctrine I believe to be false called annihilationism. It's propagated by people like Roger Foster in England of the Ictus Fellowship, one of the organizers of the March for Jesus, by John Stott from the Church of England. These people say we can't be sure there's an eternal hell. There'll be a judgment and then unsaved people will be annihilated. They won't exist anymore. When you tell unsaved people that when they die, if they haven't repented and accepted Christ, they won't exist anymore, that's what unsaved people believe anyway. So what? This life is all there is to it. It's a disincentive to evangelism, but it's a disincentive to them to get saved. We have the Hebrew term olamei olamim, forever and ever, which the Greek New Testament translates enyon ton enyones, enyon ton enyones, forever and ever. That phrase is used to describe the eternal high priesthood of Jesus. It's used to describe the eternal glory of God, and it's used to describe the eternal bliss of believers in heaven. It's also used to describe the eternal torment of those in the lake of fire. The smoke of their torment goes up enion ton eniones forever and ever. In other words, if hell is not eternal and conscious, how can you be sure heaven is? If hell is not eternal and conscious, how can you be sure heaven is? There is much deception in the church today. And characteristically, those who are teaching this doctrine of annihilationism are people who are into much serious doctrinal error across the board, particularly people caught up in restorationism and other such beliefs. Let's understand, Hebrews speaks of hell before it does reward in the earlier chapters. We have a big problem in the church today. The reality of hell is not being proclaimed to people. Now the Bible speaks of it. In Matthew's gospel alone, Jesus speaks of hell three times more than he does heaven. He speaks of judgment. We need to preach law before we can preach grace. As my friend Ray Comfort says, how many lies does somebody have to tell before they're a liar? Well, we're all liars. None of us keeps the law of God. That's just the way it is. You know, the apostle said, save yourself from this perverse generation. Jesus said, how will you escape the judgment of Gehenna? You don't find Jesus, the Hebrew prophets, John the Baptist, or the apostles preaching seeker-friendly, seeker-sensitive, don't be negative, pop psychology. You don't find them going with the Norman Vincent Peale, Robert Schuller, Bill Hybels, C. Peter Wagner, John Wimber, and Alpha Course watered-down version of the gospel, where the reality of judgment is downplayed so as not to be, quote-unquote, negative, and to make the gospel more seeker-friendly. If people know they're condemned, hopelessly lost, they'll be desperate to get saved. Hebrews speaks of hell before it does the reward. However, that's not good enough. You also have to believe that there's a heaven and God wants to reward you, to give you an incentive not to trust in this world like Moses in verse 26. He could have had a good life in this world as a prince in Egypt, but he chose the reproach of the Messiah instead. Let's continue looking at this even further. We move to the next phase, going from after the creation, the fall, then the antediluvian age, and we come to the diluvian age itself, the time of the flood. And in verse 7 we read, by faith Noah, being warned by God about things not yet seen, in reverence prepared an ark for the salvation of his household, by which he condemned the world and became an heir of the righteousness which is according to faith. The rescue of Noah and his family on the ark is again a picture of what will happen in the last days. Peter tells us this three times in his epistles, and Jesus tells us it in the Olivet Discourse. The last days will be just like the days of Noah. God is in the business of rescuing families. The importance of building up family and marital relationships in the last days is central, pivotal. Jesus said the family would come under attack. Children will turn against parents and parents against children. God wants to save whole families as he rescued Noah's family. The ark being a picture of the church that will cause people to survive, those who will be rescued out of the coming judgment. Now applying this to the believers in 70 AD, God wants to rescue whole families. Not only does he want to rescue you, he wants to rescue your family. And again, all the believing families, as far as we know, fled in 70 AD before the temple was destroyed. This epistle is preparing the believers in Jerusalem for what is about to come. The judgment predicted by Jesus, prophesied by Daniel. The last days will be the same. God is in the business of wanting to get families out of here. Now, in the last days, some of us will be Abels, martyred. Some will be Enochs, raptured. Some of us will be fortunate enough to be like Noah's, seeing our whole families taken out of here. This is what happened in 70 AD. This is what Hebrews is alluding to. And so we go from the Diluvian Age into the next age of Heilsgeschichte, which is the Patriarchal Age, the age of the fathers Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Sarah. Here, in this passage, dealing with the fathers, we move heavily into the area of typology. The kind of typology you see earlier in Hebrews concerning Melchizedek and the high priest and the Hebrew Feast of Atonement, or the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur, with the Se'er Azazel, the scapegoat, etc. Types, figures of Jesus, shadows of the New Covenant. It goes into this typology again. Again, a shadow, a hand causing a shadow. That's what the Greek word for type means. It comes from shadow. You see the shadow of something. It tells you what's coming. In this typology, we see two things. First of all, we see that Abraham would put his son Isaac on an altar. In Judaism, this is called the Akedah, the binding, the Akedah, the binding. The rabbis have a partial understanding of this that's correct. They see it as a polemic against human sacrifice. The Canaanites were sacrificing their firstborn children to demons. Moses called other gods demons, Shadim, and they were sacrificing them. And it was God intervening and saying, no more human sacrifice of this nature. Now, of course, one of the arguments that unbelieving rabbis will give against the messiahship of Jesus is that God disapproves of human sacrifice. No, he disapproves of pagan human sacrifice. The rabbis themselves agree that God believes in vicarious atonement. As we point out on some of our other tapes, although it is a misinterpretation, Rashi and all rabbis since Rashi say that Isaiah 53, the suffering servant, who's known as Ben Ephraim in the earlier or the more ancient rabbinic literature, they say is Israel suffering vicariously for the Gentile nations. Why should Israel suffer and die on behalf of others if God doesn't believe in human sacrifice? Judaism does allow for human sacrifice, but it does not allow for pagan sacrifice. Vicarious atonement is the doctrine of Judaism. It's only a doctrine of Christianity because it's found in the Hebrew scriptures. Nonetheless, this is the binding. Abraham gives his only son. Every purpose and promise of God to Abraham depended on him having a son. The son could not be reckoned to be Ishmael. God says, take your only son. He doesn't even recognize Ishmael. God never recognizes anything done in the flesh. Only the son he gives. Now, everything depends on this son, and we're called to put this son on the altar. That's the way Abraham thinks. But he knew that God could raise his son back from the dead. Again, he had a shadow, a type, the hand of the resurrection. There was enough of what he knew to show him that the promise of God had substance. He could hope in the resurrection with a hope that was a faith. In other words, once more, what he hoped in was a future fact. Secondly, this is continued on where it says that Moses, in verse 26, chose the reproach of the Messiah. How could Abraham know about what he did? And how could Moses know about the Messiah? Because they saw the shadow. and they knew that what was causing the shadow had substance. It was a convicting evidence, as it says in the first verse. The shadow was a convicting evidence because they knew what was causing the shadow had substance. Therefore, they hoped in it, but what they hoped in, they knew they could put their trust or faith in as a future fact. And so, with this background in view concerning the typology of the patriarchs, let's read this next phase. You have the creation with the Logos, the Word. Then, with the fall of man, it's represented by Abel. Then, the antediluvian period is represented by Enoch. Then, the diluvian period is represented by Noah. And now, into the patriarchal period, we have Abraham, his wife Sarah, the first woman in this list of role models, followed by Isaac, Jacob, and then Jacob's son, Joseph, with a brief mention of Esau. Let's continue. Verse 8, by faith Abraham, when he was called, obeyed by going out to a place which he was to receive for an inheritance. And he went out not knowing where he was going. By faith he lived as an alien in the land of promise, as in a foreign land, dwelling in tents with Isaac and Jacob, fellow heirs of the same promise. For he was looking for the city which has foundations, whose architect and builder is God. Now sadly, the demonic practice of Freemasonry distorts verse 19, calling God Gautu, the great architect of the universe. They ostensibly draw on Solomon in some of their recounts of their origins, Solomon building the temple and so on. In fact, the god of Freemasonry is Gautu, the great architect of the universe, whose secret name, whose mystical name, which they are told when they enter the Holy Royal Arch of the Third Degree, is in fact Yabalan, Yah being Yahweh, but Baal being the Baal of the Canaanites in the Old Testament, and On from Osiris, the Egyptian deity. It is in fact a demonic counterfeit of the Trinity. Jesus said, let no one bind you with an oath. And upon initiation to Freemasonry, people take a blood oath, but they get this idea that God is the great architect of the universe. It's quite frightening the way they distort the scriptures. They distort many scriptures out of context to support Masonic presupposition, and this is one of them. No saved Christian should ever be involved in Freemasonry. No saved Christian should ever be involved in the Masonic order. But let's continue. Abraham, we're told, was called, obeyed by going out, but he didn't know where he was going. The way the believers would have read this in the events leading up to 70 AD they were being prepared for is, we're getting out of here, but we don't know where we're going. But Abraham didn't know where he was going. He just knew that God called him out. They didn't know they were going to Pelah. They didn't know where they were heading for. Had no idea. We deal with this on our Zephaniah tape, The Hiding Places of God. They didn't know where they were bound for. They just knew that God told them to leave. This is like their father Abraham. When he left Ur of the Chaldees, he didn't know where he was going. He just knew that God told him to get out. Well, the believers in 70 AD were in the same situation. Where are we going? What are we going to do if Jerusalem's going to be destroyed? This is our home. This is where the temple is. This is where the ark was. This is the city of the Messiah. What are we going to do? Just get out. Well, where are we going? Well, did Abraham know where he was going? He just knew God called him out. He hoped for something better. He hoped for another city whose architect and builder was God. Now, ultimately, this points to heaven, heavenly Jerusalem. And so the believers in 70 AD were being encouraged not to trust in temporal Jerusalem, but eternal Jerusalem. Now, this is in no way to diminish the prophetic importance in eschatology, or in biblical prophecy of the end times of modern Jerusalem. There is no doubt whatsoever that the Jews are regathered to Israel for the Great Tribulation and to be deceived by the Antichrist. They're going back to Israel for the time of Jacob's trouble, HaTekufat HaTzarat Yaakov. They're being regathered in unbelief to come under a final judgment of God that will result in two-thirds of them being destroyed, according to Zechariah. But of the ones who survive, they'll look upon the Messiah who was pierced and mourn as one mourns for an only son, and so all Israel will be saved. We cannot diminish the importance of modern Israel or modern Jerusalem. Jesus said directly, Jerusalem will be trampled down by the feet of the Gentiles until the time of the Gentiles is completed. He used the Greek terms pletheron and ethnon, the same two words, until the time of the nations that Paul uses in Romans chapter 11. We cannot deny or doubt the prophetic significance of modern Jerusalem. The book of Zechariah chapter 12, where the return of Christ is predicted and described, depends on the Jews being in Jerusalem, just as Jesus himself said in Luke chapter 21, in Luke's version of the Olivet Discourse. Having said that, in 70 AD, the believers were told, get ready to flee. God has another Jerusalem for us, a Jerusalem above, the one we read about in the book of Revelation, which would later be written at the end of the first century, approximately 25 years later. In any event, we're also told that Abraham dwelt as a sojourner in a land promised to him. This is like us. The meek will inherit the earth. One of the deceptions in the early church was invented by Augustine of Hippo, the idea of amillennialism and the idea later of postmillennialism, that the millennium was fulfilled in the church. Jesus said his kingdom is not of this world. These concepts of postmillennialism and amillennialism have no biblical basis whatsoever. The early Christians never believed such nonsense. Anytime the church has tried to become a political power, it has resulted in debauchery, be it the medieval papacy or Calvin's police state in Geneva or the Puritan witch burnings in Massachusetts and England. Anytime the church has vied for political power and tried to establish the kingdom of God on earth, it has resulted in debauchery, spiritual and moral death to the church, and contamination of the society at large. We are called to be salt and light, an influence for the Lord and the gospel in the world, but not of the world. This alludes to the millennial reign of Jesus. Abraham was promised that land. So the believers in 70 AD are promised the land and the city. There will be a millennial reign of Jesus. He will reign from Jerusalem. Don't worry, you're going to get this place when Jesus comes back. And so it is for us. We shouldn't worry either. We will get this place when Jesus comes back. The meek will inherit the earth. The pre-Nicene church was almost uniformly pre-millennial. When you understand the Jewish background of the Gospels, it's impossible to be anything else. Amillennialism and postmillennialism are distortions invented by a Gentile Christianity that corrupted the original teachings of Jesus in order to accommodate the pseudo-Christianization of the Roman Empire, begetting the Christendom which took us into the Dark Ages. It has nothing whatsoever to do with the Christianity of the New Testament taught by Jesus and the apostles, which is pre-millennial. You know, people would have no problem saying, well, the 3.5 years in Revelation is literal. Well, then why isn't 1,000 years literal? You can't spiritualize one and take the other literally. It's just a nonsense. There's an inconsistency. Quite an inconsistency. You have to wind up engaging in Gnosticism and spiritualization of texts to arrive at the errors of postmillennialism and amillennialism, which were alien to the thinking of the early church. Abraham dwelt as a foreigner in a land promised him. And so we as Christians live as foreigners in this life, but we will get it. The original plan God had for this planet to give to his people will become a reality in the millennial reign of Jesus. And to the believers in 70 AD, that's what it meant. Don't worry. Live as a foreigner in this place. It's promised to you as it's promised to Abraham. We'll have it. But let's go on. In verse 11, by faith, even Sarah herself received the ability to conceive, even beyond the proper time of life, since she considered him faithful who had promised. Again, God's promise, what she hoped in, had substance, so there was sufficient evidence or conviction to have trust or faith in it. Again, the hand. Therefore also, there was born of one man, and him as good as dead, at that as many descendants as the stars of heaven in number, and innumerable as the sand which is by the seashore. We deal with this on our Stars That Shine video and tape. The descendants of Abraham being compared to stars. Paul draws on the same imagery in 1 Corinthians 15, where he speaks of Christians in the resurrection as star differing from star in their glory, as does Daniel chapter 12, describing Christians and Jews who believe in the resurrection as stars that shine forever. The imagery of the stars we deal with on the Stars That Shine tapes and video. But Abraham's descendants are called stars. Abraham has anthropological descendants, the Jewish and Arab nations. But his spiritual descendants are those who believe in the seed of Abraham, the Messiah, both Jew and Gentile. So the first female figure we have in this list of role models is Sarah. And we read verse 13, all these died in faith without receiving the promises, but having seen them and having welcomed them from a distance and having confessed that they were strangers and exiles on the earth. For those who say such things, make it clear that they are seeking a country. They would have had opportunity to return. But as it is, they desire a better country, that is a heavenly one. Therefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he has prepared a city for them. By faith, Abraham, when he was tested, offered up Isaac, and he who had received the promises was offering up his only begotten son. It was he to whom it was said, in Isaac your descendants shall be called. He considered that God is able to raise men even from the dead, from which he also received him back as a type. The resurrection was talked about, of course, in the book of Daniel, chapter 12, Job 19, and in various of the Psalms. He had the shadow, and he could have faith in his hope in the resurrection. Now, we're told in verse 13 that they didn't get what they wanted. They saw it at a distance. Again, consistent with the overall theme of Hebrews of a shadow. You don't see the hand on the surface. You only see the shadow. The hand you see at a distance through its shadow. And so they saw the coming of the Messiah and the new covenant, the gospel, through its shadow, the Torah, the Pentateuch, the law. But that is an example to us as it was to the believers in 70 AD. Although they didn't get it, they died in faith without receiving it. Why didn't they get it then? Why didn't Abraham and Sarah get it then? The reason they didn't get it then is given to us at the end of the chapter. Look at verse 39. All of these, having gained approval through their faith, did not receive what was promised, because God had provided something better for us, so that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. The reason they did not get it then is because God wants to give it to us too. They will get it when we get it. we will get it when they get it. Whether you are martyred like Abel or raptured like Enoch, we get it together. The dead in Christ rise first. As we often point out, the clearest illustration of the rapture is the transfiguration of Jesus, which Peter thought to be the messianic fulfillment of the Hebrew Feast of Tabernacles in Zechariah 14. He thought it was the beginning of the millennium. Here's the Messiah, here's Moses, here's Elijah. Let me build the booths, the Feast of Tabernacles. He thought that was the beginning of the millennial reign of Jesus. You have Moses, a man who died faithful to God, and Elijah, a man who was raptured, meeting the Lord in the air, as it was exemplified, or as it was illustrated by it happening on Mount Hermon, where Galilee, Lebanon, and the Golan Heights come together, the highest mountain in Israel. They meet the Lord in the air. It doesn't matter if you are martyred like Abel or raptured like Enoch. It doesn't matter if you die in the Lord like Moses or are raptured like Elijah. We shall be as he is. We get it when they get it, and they get it when we get it. They were promised it, and they died without receiving it, but they're still going to get it. They'll get it when we get it. Again, this further underlines the folly of amillennialism and postmillennialism. There must be a millennium for a variety of reasons, including this one. But let's go further. They were seeking a country of their own, a better country. And so are we. Ultimately, of course, this is the eternal kingdom in Jerusalem. In verse 17, the patriarchal phase of Israel's history continues. He offers up Isaac, his son, and gets him back as a type of Jesus. Everything depended on that one son. And so the entire plan of God depended on God's one son. If Isaac was to die, all the promises to Abraham couldn't come about. Therefore, Abraham knew that God had to raise his son. And so it was with us. Had Abraham killed him, God would have had to raise him from the dead. With Jesus, every promise of God depends on God's own son, his only son, only begotten son, monogenes in Greek. If Jesus was killed for the same reason, God would have had to raise him back from the dead. Because his promise is sure. What we hope in is a future fact. We put faith in something that has substance. Let's continue. By faith, Isaac blessed Jacob and Esau in verse 20, even regarding things to come. Now we have a tape entitled Jewish-Arab Reconciliation in Christ, also to be available on video, where we explain how Jacob and Esau represent the Jewish and Arab nations in biblical prophecy. God has a list of prophetic purposes for both the Jewish nation and the Arab nation. But we'll deal with this, of course, under other auspices. I only mention it in passing. Let's continue. By faith, Jacob, as he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph and worshipped, leaning on the top of his staff. By faith, Joseph, when he was dying, made mention of the exodus of the sons of Israel and gave orders concerning his bones. Joseph and Moses are two very important shadows of Jesus. We call Jesus in Hebrew Ben David Yeshua, a suffering servant who was rejected, then exalted, who was betrayed by his brothers into the hands of Gentiles, but God turning the betrayal around and making it a way for all Israel and all the world to be saved. In fact, Joseph was betrayed by his brother Yehuda for 20 pieces of silver, as Jesus was betrayed by Yehuda, Judas, for 30 pieces of silver, etc. Joseph was not recognized at his first coming, but at the second. And so Jesus is not recognized by his Jewish brothers at the first coming, but the second. Now, what's important here about Joseph is he gave orders concerning his bones. Again, the Exodus, they brought Joseph's bones with them out of Egypt. The dead in Christ rise first. We come out together. Coming out of Egypt is a figure of the rapture and the resurrection. We come out together. He hoped in it. He hoped. He had faith in it, enough faith to say, take my bones. And so we have the prophecy of Jacob to the sons of Israel in the book of Genesis chapter 49. The ultimate fulfillment of Jacob's prophecy in Genesis 49 will be in the book of Revelation, chapters 7 and 14. He knew that what God showed him concerning his sons was something he could hope in, and it had substance. Lo and behold, the book of Revelation tells us what he hoped in for his sons will come into reality. His sons, of course, being patriarchs of the tribes, representing God's prophetic destiny for the Jewish nation. But let's go beyond this. We alas come to Moses in the first section of this teaching. By faith, Moses, when he was born, was hidden for 3 months by his parents because they saw he was a beautiful child and they were not afraid of the king's edict. Moses was hidden by the faith of his parents from a wicked king in Egypt and protected for a season, again typifying Jesus, who was protected by the faith of his parents and hidden for a season in Egypt. Moses was protected and hidden from a wicked king. Jesus was protected and hidden from a wicked king, both of them for a season in Egypt. Moses foreshadowing again the Messiah. By faith, Moses, when he'd grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasure of sin, considering the reproach of the Messiah greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. By faith he left Egypt, not fearing the wrath of the king, for he endured as seeing him who was unseen. By faith he kept the Passover and the sprinkling of the blood, so that he who destroyed the firstborn might not touch them. By faith they passed through the Red Sea, as though they were passing through dry land, and the Egyptians, when they attempted it, were drowned. What it's saying to the believers in 70 AD, or the events leading up to it, in the years prior to it, when this is written, 62 AD or so, is this. Moses could have had a good life in this world, but he endured reproach with the people of God, looking for the reward that would come in and through the Messiah. Let Moses be an example to us. Endure the reproach. So we're rejected by the synagogue. So we are persecuted by the Sanhedrin, and now by the Romans. But look at Moses. Moses could have had a good life in this world, but he turned his back on it. Yes, you can go back and you can fall away from the Lord, backslide and go back to the synagogue. Spare yourself persecution and maybe have a good life in this world, temporarily. But God's judgment is going to come on Jerusalem. Remember Daniel's prophecy. Remember Jesus' warning. Rather be like Moses. Endure ill treatment now. Take reproach with the people of God. Don't fear the king. As Moses didn't fear Pharaoh, why should you fear Nero? That's what it would have meant to them. And in the last days, that same message very much becomes the same exhortation to us. Endure ill treatment with the people of God. Don't trust in this world, even if you could have a good life in it. And don't fear that wicked king. Ultimately, of course, both Nero and Pharaoh typify the Antichrist. Following Moses, the Exodus, the next phase of Heilsgeschichte, or Israel's salvation history, is the conquest. Only conspicuously, instead of associating Joshua as the lead figure representing the conquest, it gives Rahab, the second woman after Sarah, introduced it to the list of role models. And not only is she a woman, but she is a Gentile woman. Hence, following the Exodus, we have the conquest. And we read the following, verse 30. By faith, the walls of Jericho fell down after they had been encircled for 7 days. Now, Jerusalem was going to be encircled, as Jesus warned in Luke 21, 24, when you see Jerusalem surrounded. It had that nuance inherent in the text. By faith, Rahab the harlot did not perish along with those who were disobedient after she had welcomed the spies in peace. Rahab was a harlot. This idea of the rescue of Rahab, well, she repented, turned to faith in the true God, and sided with his people, and was rescued. This, again, would have had a peculiar meaning to the Jewish people who believed in 70 AD, as the Roman destruction was looming when the epistle was written several years earlier. There's a comparison being made to what transpired back in Jericho with Joshua that happened with the rescue of Rahab. As Rahab made it out in her family, you can make it out with your family in 70 AD, which was going to come in a few years' time. Again, this has an eschatological or an end times allusion, or alludes to that, has a specific meaning for the Jews of the first century church. Let's understand why it specifies seven. Seven. We are told in verse 30, for 7 days. We have tapes explaining this in greater depth, such as understanding the Great Tribulation. However, a Jewish believer reading the book of Revelation in the end of the first century or the beginning of the second century would have seen it as a midrash on the book of Joshua chapter 6. You have a literary parallelism and a historical parallelism between the story of Joshua and the story of Revelation and the return of Christ. Specifically, the Levites had to be totally silent when they marched around Jericho. And so in the book of Revelation, we read there was silence in heaven for a half hour. We have two Greek words for time, kairos and chronos. I don't know how you apply time to eternity. I know there's chronos, that is chronology in eternity, but there's no kairos. There's no time in the sense of a clock. Yet we read that there was silence in heaven for a half hour. Be that as it may, the Levites had to be totally silent in Joshua when they're going to march around Jericho, and there was silence in heaven. They marched around Jericho 7 days, but the seventh day, they had to do it seven times. You have seven, but from the seventh seven, you have a subset of seven. That is, the seventh day, they had to do it seven times. And so in Revelation, you have the same numerical sequence. You have seven seals, but from the seventh seven comes seven trumpets. Seven, and from the seventh seven derives seven. That happens in Joshua, and it happens in Revelation. When they blow the last trumpet in Joshua, it's proclaimed, "This city has been given to us by the Lord." Words to that effect. When they blow the last trumpet in Revelation, this world has become the kingdom of our God and his Messiah. What transpired in Jericho in the book of Joshua happens again in the book of Revelation. The conquest of Jericho prefigures the conquest of the Lord of this world when he makes war against the kingdom of Antichrist. Somehow, the rescue of Rahab and her family foreshadow or typify the rescue of the church. In some way, those two spies, the Meraglim, the two spies sent by Joshua, prefigure the ministry of the two witnesses in Revelation. Now, many people ask the question, are the two witnesses Moses and Elijah, or Moses and the Apostle John, or is it Moses and Enoch? Many people prefigure those two witnesses in different ways. The two angels who rescued Lot in figure typify those two witnesses. The two olive trees in the book of Zechariah prefigure plainly those two witnesses. But so do these two spies prefigure the two witnesses in Revelation. It's the same sequence. The seven, but from the seventh seven comes a subset of seven. There has to be total silence. And then they blow the last trumpet, and there is the victory. But in the middle of this, you have two spies, two witnesses, somehow paralleling each other in a rescue narrative. Now, I only mention this in passing. We have other tapes that go into this in greater depth. You normally won't find this kind of thing in commentary because it's dealing with Midrash. It's more akin to what you'd see in the Dead Sea Scrolls than what you would see in the typical Protestant commentary or the Catholic commentaries. But I assure you, a Jewish believer at the end of the first century would have seen these kinds of parallelisms. And so we have the story there of Rahab. From the conquest, it moves on to the period of judges, what we call in Hebrew, Hatekufat HaShoftim, the period of the judges. And we read in verse 32, and what more shall I say? For time will fail me if I tell of Gideon, Barak, Samson, Jephthah. And following those four, it moves in the same verse to the last period, the period of kings and prophets, or the period of prophets and kings, the last era before the captivity of Babylon, represented by David and Samuel, respectively, in the period of kings and prophets. And so again, from the creation, we go from the creation throughout Heilsgeschichte to the fall, represented by Abel, antediluvian man, represented by Enoch, diluvian man, represented by Noah, the patriarchal era, represented by Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Sarah, and Joseph, the Exodus era, represented, of course, by Moses, the conquest, represented by Rahab, and then the period of judges, represented by Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, and finally the period of kings and prophets, represented by David and Samuel, respectively. In verse 33, of them we read, who by faith conquered kingdoms, performed acts of righteousness, obtained promises, shut the mouths of lions, quenched the power of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, from weakness were made strong, became mighty in war, and they put foreign armies to flight. Women received back their dead by resurrection. Up until the beginning of verse 35, this is the kind of faith I like. Quenching the power of fire, escaping from the edge of the sword, from weakness being made strong, mighty in war, putting armies to flight, receiving back the dead by resurrection. I like that kind of faith talk. But then we read the rest of it. Others were tortured, not accepting their release, in order that they might obtain a better resurrection. Again, they hoped in the resurrection. They knew what they hoped in had substance, so they had faith in it. Others were experienced mockings and scourgings, also chains and imprisonment. They were stoned. They were sawn in two. They were tempted. They were put to death with the sword. They went about in sheepskins and goatskins, being destitute, afflicted, ill-treated, men of whom the world was not worthy, staying in five-star hotels, salubrious mansions, riding in Mercedes limousines, and wearing expensive suits from Fifth Avenue and Savile Row. Sorry, I thought I was in Oklahoma. I'll read it again. Because of their faith, they were wandering in deserts, mountains, caves, and holes in the ground. All of these having gained approval through their faith, but they did not receive what was promised because God has provided something better for us so that apart from us, they should not be made perfect. Obviously, as we deal with on the Emunah tape, you cannot believe the faith that comes from the faith prosperity preachers in America and South Africa, and the faith of Hebrews 11. The New Testament teaches faith in Jesus. These people teach faith in faith. The beliefs of Kenneth Hagin and Kenneth Copeland come from E.W. Kenyon, a man who said Satan, not Jesus, got the victory on the cross. That Jesus became of one nature with Satan in hell and had to be born again in hell after being tortured 3 days and three nights. Based on this, Kenneth Copeland once said that he could have died on the cross because he's born again. This is an outrage, an absolute outrage. On the cross, Jesus said, "It was finished. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." Jesus got the victory, not Satan. Kenyon was a deceiver and a liar, and those who follow him teach doctrines of devils. You don't have to suffer. You're a king's kid. God wants you rich. Name it and claim it. Blab it and grab it. It's faith in faith. It's not faith in Jesus. You can be a follower of Jesus Christ and believe the New Testament. Or you can be a follower of Kenneth Copeland and Kenneth Hagin, but you can't follow both. You either believe the faith in Jesus or you believe faith in faith. If you want to be a Christian, believe the faith of Hebrews 11. If you want to worship mammon, if you want to call the sin of covetousness faith, then you can believe the faith prosperity preachers from America and South Africa. If you want to be a Christian, be a Christian. If you want to worship mammon, but no man can serve two masters. These people suffered for their faith. Now, of course, the liars Satan has raised up today say, you don't have to suffer, you're a king's kid. If you suffer, you don't have any faith. Well, these people did suffer because of their faith. And there are Christians in the world who are suffering today because of their faith. This faith, people whose hope is not in this world, who love not their lives in this world even unto death. Ones like Moses who are looking forward to the true reward. These money preachers from America and South Africa are truly the false prophets that Jesus said would come to deceive the elect in the last days. They have lying spirits. They are deceivers. You can either believe this faith or the faith of the money preachers. Faith in Christ or faith in faith. If you want to follow Jesus Christ, by all means follow Jesus Christ. If you want to follow the money preachers, follow the money preachers, but you cannot follow both. That is emunah, but we are looking at tikvah. That is talking about faith. Our focus in this study, however, is the one of hope. This is God's list of role models. Abel was a man who was martyred. Enoch was a man who was raptured. But then with Noah, things begin to change. Before Abraham, there were no Jews. Abraham was a Gentile who God converted to Judaism, as was his wife Sarah. Abraham was the first Hebrew, as it were. Something begins to take place in Israel's salvation history. It's there incipiently with Noah, but with Abraham, it really takes off. Why was Abraham both a Jew and a Gentile who God converted to Judaism? It is because the seed of Abraham, the Messiah, would be the savior of both Jew and Gentile. Hence, Abraham was both a Jew and a Gentile. From him, the Messiah would come. Now, let's look even more clearly. God's list of role models. They're given to us as examples. Examples of faith, examples of people who trusted in what they hoped for. For by it the men of old gained approval. What men of old? Noah? Noah went out and got loaded. He got drunk. He embarrassed his family, making a spectacle of himself and bringing God's judgment on the Canaanite nation, who Joshua would later obliterate. That was Noah, a man who went out and got drunk, hurt his family, brought a curse on a nation. Then there was Abraham, the father of all who believed. Abraham is called the friend of God. Yedidia in Hebrew, Jedidiah, the name Jedidiah comes from it. Abraham was willing to sexually give his wife over to another man. Not once, but twice. Sarah was his half-sister, so he told half the truth. He lied. Willing to give his wife over to another man sexually, and then turns around and does it again. Then his son Isaac does the same thing. Commits the same sin as his father. We are told here in Hebrews 11 that Sarah believed God for a son. But when we read the book of Genesis, we see a very different Sarah. She doubted. That's why she named the son Isaac. It's Hoke in Hebrew. Itzak, he shall laugh, from the infinitive Itzhok, to laugh. She balked at the idea. Forget it, hang it up, you're past it, granny. What, a geriatric pregnancy? She didn't believe. Hebrews 11 tells us she believed. Genesis tells us she doubted. Hebrews 11 tells us that Noah was a man of faith who hoped in God. Genesis tells us he was a drunk. Hebrews 11 tells us that Noah was a righteous man, not a drunk. That Abraham was the friend of God, the father of all who believed. That's what it says in Hebrews. Genesis tells us he was a liar, willing to give his man over to another woman, his wife over to another man. Not once, but twice. And his son turns out the same way. But the list gets even worse. Joseph, of course, suffered rejection. He was rejected. Being rejected by unbelievers is one thing, but being rejected by believers is something else. Then to be rejected by your own family is worst of all. The only person in the entire Bible who experienced more rejection than Joseph was Jesus himself. You may know what it's like to experience rejection. But I doubt if any of us have experienced the rejection of Joseph. Joseph was unjustly framed for a sex crime. He was criminally sentenced for a sex crime he never committed. What a sad case. And then after him, of course, comes Moses. They didn't have to frame Moses for anything. He did knock the Egyptian off and have to blow the country. He committed murder. He was a killer. He had to go dwell on the land of Midian after he killed an Egyptian. There was mitigation, but he still knocked them off. That's a role model. Of course, Jacob, if we were to look at Jacob's defects, we'd be here all day and all night. But skipping down further to the judges and to Rahab, it becomes almost ludicrous. Rahab was a harlot, a prostitute. That's a role model? Certainly not someone I want my daughter to look up to. Good time, dearie. Hello, lovey. There's a problem. Why would God make a town whore a hooker, a role model? A hooker is a role model? But then we go beyond her to the judges. Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah. Gideon couldn't have qualified for his own army. We all know about the story of the fleece. But that's only one instance. Every couple of verses, Gideon was doubting God. Oh, Lord, give me a sign. Oh, God, please speak to me. Oh, don't be angry, Lord. Please confirm again I'm in your will. That's not exactly the portrait of a great man of faith. That's a man of continual doubt and weakness and insecurity. He couldn't have even gotten into his own army in the beginning. Yet God makes him a role model. Then there's Barak. Yael and Deborah wore the trousers. Barak wore the skirt. Whenever God uses women in ministry, he will never circumvent male authority. Leadership is always male. Always. What do you see in the Bible? Well, whenever God uses an Esther, you'll find a Mordecai. Whenever God uses a Barak, you'll find, or uses a Deborah, you'll find a Barak. He will not circumvent male authority. Even when the men are not taking responsibility and he must use women, he still will not circumvent his line of spiritual authority. God does not violate his own principles. The concept of women pastors is completely and wholly unbiblical. We have a tape called The Daughters of Zion where we explain this, but let's go a bit further. After reading about Gideon and Barak, we come to Samson. Samson's a role model? When you read the book of Judges, you'd wonder why God would make him a role model. What a sucker for a babe. Delilah was his second mistake. This wasn't the girl next door. This wasn't the someone who was emotionally vulnerable to him. This was a wicked woman, a femme fatale, trying to get him killed. Yet he shares the secrets of his heart with her. What a jerk. How could a man of such power and strength called by God be such a sucker for a woman? But God makes him a role model. And then we move on to Jephthah. Jephthah had a unique talent for painting himself into a corner with his tongue, making a rash promise to God, a vow, obligating himself to take the life of his own daughter. And then we get to David and Samuel and the prophets. Samuel got to be where he was because and only because the sons of Eli were backslidden and unbelieving. That's why he got to be where he was. Because the sons of Eli were backslidden and unbelieving. But then the prophet Samuel sees his own sons turn out to be the same way. How many men have succeeded in the ministry but failed as husbands and fathers? Let that be a warning to all of us. Yet God too makes him, Samuel, a role model. And then, alas, we have King David, the greatest of them all. David's second sin of numbering the people was actually worse than the first. The second sin had consequences for the entire nation, but his first sin had consequences only for himself and his family, mainly. But look at David. Not on the worst day of your Christian life, not on the worst day of your Christian life, could you or I even begin to fathom, to contemplate what David actually did? He took a righteous man, Uriah, my light is Yahweh, a righteous man who was loyal to God's word, loyal to his country, and loyal to David, his king, a righteous, loyal man, and then David misuses his authority and position as king to virtually have him killed. He may as well have put a contract on him. Why? In order to take his wife. David could have had any woman in Israel he wanted, and he had to have a man killed to take his wife. And then once he did it, after he did it, he pretends as if nothing happened. When the prophet Nathan initially comes to him, David's reaction is, so what? Not on the worst day of your Christian life could you even approximate, could you even begin to concoct something that David actually did. Yet God takes King David and makes him the Old Testament shadow of Christ as good shepherd and as faithful king. Why? Hebrews 11 tells us about these people one way, while the Old Testament tells us about them quite another. There's a term called hagiography. All religions, all false religions, and all cults are hagiographic, from the Greek word hagios, holy, making holy. They make people superhuman. They ascribe, as it were, almost sinless characters to people. Now, when you see a human being other than Jesus, who was God and man, being made to appear sinless, or being ascribed with supernatural qualities of a divine nature, this is the spirit of Antichrist. Antichrist, again, does not only mean or primarily mean against Christ. It means in place of. You're putting somebody else in that position, making them look perfect. Only Jesus perfectly kept the law of God. Only Jesus had no sin. The Bible is not hagiographic. The Bible tells the truth about Noah and his drinking, Abraham and his lying, and his son turning out the same. It tells the truth about Moses being a killer. It tells the truth about Jephthah and his rash vows. It tells the truth about David's deadly sin. The Bible is not hagiographic. God is realistic and his word is realistic. It is only Jesus who's perfect and sinless. Other religions are hagiographic. Look at them. Judaism will sanctify the name of someone called Bar Kokhba. And they'll sanctify the name of Rabbi Akiva, who proclaimed Bar Kokhba to be the Messiah. Now the Israeli general and archaeologist Igal Yadin, who excavated Betar, where the Roman battle against Bar Kokhba took place near Bethlehem, tells us that Bar Kokhba was a man who kicked a 90-year-old rabbi in the head and murdered him. Bar Kokhba was reckless. He was a false messiah. He got the people driven out of their land for centuries. Yet, thanks to hagiography, his name is esteemed in Judaism. The Roman Catholic Church will canonize as saints people who were wicked, popes who were warlords, who were closet homosexuals, who were treacherous. They have Saint Dominic. Saint Dominic never wrote anything, but his followers, the Dominicans, said that he taught that because Eve was made from the rib of Adam and the rib of a male is crooked, that there's something devious and crooked about women. During the Inquisitions, it's estimated by some scholars that the Dominicans tortured and murdered up to 500,000 people. But they were particularly fond of torturing women using boiling water and gynecological tortures, following the ethos of their founder, Saint Dominic. Saint Dominic claimed that the Virgin Mary appeared to him, gave him a rosary bead, and told him to pray the rosary holding the Madonna holding the baby. In fact, counting prayers on beads was a pagan practice of Vishnu, of the Hindus, which the Crusades brought back from the East. Saint Dominic was no saint. His followers were murderers. It's a legacy that continues to this day. In the year 2000, two Dominican nuns were criminally sentenced in Belgium for their role in the genocide of 70,000 people. 7,000 people? Two nuns involved in the genocidal slaughter of 7,000 people in the Rwanda situation and the Burundi situation between the Hutu and Tutsi tribe. To this day, the legacy of Dominic is perpetuated, yet they make him a saint. Of course, what the Dominicans did prior to the Reformation was only the cartoon before the movie, compared to what the Jesuits did after the Reformation. Yet, they canonized Ignatius of Loyola. Ignatius of Loyola was a madman. He used the occult practice of meditations based on exercises that were imaginations. It was a form of brainwashing. He taught through doing these exercises, someone would be conformed to a level of spirituality so that if the church, that is the Pope, said it was broad daylight when it was dark out, people would believe it was broad daylight. And if it was broad daylight, if they were told it was dark by the Pope, they would believe it through this occult practice, something imitated today by Joyce Huguette and other so-called evangelical writers. Yet they canonize this man as saint. with no, absolutely no recognition of the countless people murdered by and under the influences of the Jesuits. Oh, it's Saint Ignatius Loyola, Saint Dominic. Islam reverences Mohammed. Essentially, they lift him above Jesus. He's the greatest of them all. Mohammed married Aisha when she was 6 years old. Took her virginity when she was 9. Mohammed was a pedophile. According to the Hadith, he was the son-in-law of Abu Bakr and married Aisha when she was a little girl. He was a sex pervert who had sex with a little girl, yet he's their prophet. The Mormons venerate Joseph Smith and Brigham Young. Joseph Smith was a swindler. Brigham Young had 23 wives. The Jehovah's Witnesses beatify Charles Taze Russell and Judge Rutherford, a pair of lying swindlers. But they make them holy men. All false religions will in some way beatify their heroes, even when their heroes are bad men. We can only think of Pope John Paul II going to Yugoslavia, paying homage to Archbishop Stepanak, a Nazi collaborator, who played a role in the genocidal extermination of 750,000 people, and Pope John Paul II goes and pays homage to him. They want to have him beatified. All false religion does this. It only tells you the good points about such people, and much of the good points they attribute to them are inventions. The Bible's not like that. The Word of God's not like that. We're told the truth about David, his bad points and his good. We're told the truth about Abraham, his bad points and his good. We're told the truth about Gideon, his bad points and his good. Jesus alone is the name above all names. So the question becomes, if the Old Testament tells us that these people had major problems, why does Hebrews pretend it never happened? How can God treat these people as if they never did it? Noah got drunk and embarrassed his family, brought a curse on a nation. Abraham lied, gave his wife over to another man sexually, then turned around and did it again, and his son turns out the same way. Moses was a murderer. David was the worst of them all. How can God treat these people as if they never did it? God can treat them as if they never did it for the same reason he treats you and I as if we never did it. The reason God can treat them as if they never did it, and the reason God can treat us as if we never did it, is because he treated his own son Jesus as if he did do it. That's the gospel. As far as God's concerned, by the time you get to the new covenant, they never did it. He will not remember our sins against us. He can pretend or treat them as if they never did it. For the same reason, he can treat us as if we never did it. Because he treated Jesus as if he did. The just for the unjust. That is the true gospel. But again, why pick such a list of role models? Noah? Abraham? Samson? David? Rahab? Why pick them? They seem like hopeless characters when you read about them in the Old Testament. That's true. They're hopeless. So are we, hopeless. But there is hope for the hopeless. We can have faith, because what we have faith in has substance. Noah, did you ever know a Christian who had a problem with alcohol or substance abuse? I have. I've known Christians who had that problem. There was hope for Noah. What about Abraham? Did you ever tell a lie, a serious lie? Or fall into a serious sin and repent and say, "Dear Lord, I'll never do that again," and then you turn around and do the same thing again? Abraham did. No wonder he's the father of all who believe, because most believers are just like him. Seems hopeless. But there's hope for the hopeless. There's hope for Abraham. There's hope for me, and there's hope for you. And then his son Isaac does the same thing. Did you ever see a sin in your own children that you know they got from your bad example as a parent, as a mother, or a father? I've seen things in my son Eli. My son's an Israeli teenager. And sometimes I just wanted to grab him and wring his neck. But it would be like grabbing my own self in the mirror. I know where he got it. Where did Jacob learn to connive? His mother. We not only pass on godly qualities to our children, we can pass on some defects. Did you ever pass on some bad attributes to your own children? Well, Abraham did. There was hope for him and hope for his son. And there's hope for your son or your daughter and mine. There's hope for the hopeless. What about Joseph? Who could have suffered more rejection? And Moses? Moses committed a capital crime. He was a murderer. He had to leave the country. Yet God makes him the one who he would use to deliver Israel? A criminal? A lot of people get saved in prison. Poor Joseph was framed. They didn't have to frame Moses for anything. He did it. And then we move on to Rahab. A harlot, a prostitute, a hooker, a whore is a role model? Well, there's hope for a prostitute. Who isn't there hope for? And then we move on to the judges. Jephthah. Did you ever make a foolish promise or vow to God you couldn't keep? Well, there was hope for Jephthah. There's hope for you. Then there's Barak, a man who did not have the fortitude, courage, and just the sheer vumph to exercise the kind of responsibility and leadership he should. You know, it's very difficult for Christian women with unsaved husbands. But what's pathetic is when they have Christian husbands who are not taking the responsibility for the spiritual headship of the family and marriage as husbands and fathers. So they're forcing the wife and mother into the position of having to be the spiritual head of the family because they don't want to take responsibility. Yet they're supposedly Christian men. They seem hopeless. Hey, listen, lady, look at Barak. If there's hope for that wimp, there's hope for the pathetic excuse for a head covering you're married to. There's hope for the hopeless. And then we move on to Samson. What a sucker for a babe. And he keeps going back to her. Hey, couldn't he find a nice Jewish girl? But God raises him up. Samson, did you ever have a sin you kept falling back into again and again and again? Now with him, we know what it is. It may be something sexual, it may be something else, but everybody's got a weakness. Everybody has something. It seems like it's hopeless. And if we don't get victory over it, it can destroy us as it did Samson. But once more, there's hope for the hopeless. Samson, Jephthah, then Barak, Gideon, someone who continually doubts God. Oh Lord, give me another sign. Oh God, please don't be angry. Please confirm your will. I know a lot of Christians like that. I guess there's a bit of that in all of us at times, but some people are hung up on it. It defines their faith walk, or their lack of faith. Gideon seemed hopeless. But with God, there's hope for the hopeless. Look how we ended up. God sees the end from the beginning. We read in Philippians chapter 1, verse 6, "He who began a good work in you will bring it to completion in the day of Christ Jesus." But let's move on. Samuel, do you have backslidden and unbelieving children who break your heart? Oh God, how can you use me when my children are not walking with you? The same way that God could use Samuel when his children were not walking with him. When they're young and small and still growing and living at home, if you don't manage your own household well, you can't be a leader in the church, we're told in Timothy. But once children grow up, they have to work out their own relationship with the Lord for themselves, just as we do. It's heartbreaking when children go away from the Lord. Usually they come back. The Bible says, raise a child up in the way he should go, and he will not forever depart from it. Usually they come back to the Lord. The question is, how much of an unnecessary mess do they make of their lives? And how much unnecessary heartbreak do they cause their parents and themselves before they do come back? But they usually come back. There's hope for the hopeless. And then we have David. He did something so bad, it's unfathomable. Hopeless. But look what God made him. Why does it have this hopeless list as a list of role models? Precisely because they are hopeless. But if there's hope for them, there's hope for us. If there's hope for Noah and his drink problem, there's hope for you and yours. If there's hope for Samson and his sex or sin problem, there's hope for you and yours. If there's hope for Barak and his unwillingness to be the spiritual head, there's hope for you and for your husband. There's hope for the hopeless. Look at it once more. Faith is the assurance, the hypostasis, the substance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. You can't see it yet. You only see the shadow. But you know there's a hand. Something of substance is causing that shadow, even though you can't see it on the surface. Faith is future fact. Hope is future fact. You can put trust in a future fact. You can put trust in it. You can have faith in it. Hope is a future fact that you can put your faith in. You can trust it. He who began a good work will bring it to completion in the day of Christ Jesus. We say, I wish. I hope means I wish. That's not the biblical definition. Oh, I wish I could get victory over this sin. Oh, I wish I would be a better father. Oh, I wish I'd be a better mother or a better husband. Oh, I wish I could get victory over my drink problem. Oh, I wish. Oh, I wish. I wish, I wish, I wish. I wish nothing. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen. I wish, I wish, I wish. I know, I know, I know. God bless.